Welcome to the fourth lecture in the series of Signification in Buddhist and French traditions. The first lecture was introductory, where we introduced the themes of the Buddhist theory of signification, Apohavad, and French conceptualism with Abelard, Condillac, and Merleau-Ponty. In the second lecture, we concentrated on the Buddhist theory of Apoha and concentrated on the Buddhist logician Dharmakirti. The third lecture was consecrated to the French logician of 12th century, Abelard. Today, in the fourth lecture, we will talk about the theory of names and we will begin with the Buddhist logician Dignaga. The following lecture, fifth lecture, will deal with the French philosopher of the 18th century, Condillac. A short introductory note on the Buddhist logician Dignaga is a quote from D.N. Shastri's Critique of Indian Realism, Agra University, 1964. He says, "The advent of Dignaga is indeed one of the greatest events in the history of Indian philosophy. He can, as a matter of right, claim a place among those pioneers of human thought who discovered an eternal truth and made a lasting contribution to human knowledge. Sometime during the 5th century, there appeared in the firmament of Indian philosophy a brilliant star in the person of Dignaga, the founder of Buddhist logic and epistemology. Regarded by the Tibetans as an ornament of Jambudvipa, he was one of the greatest thinkers that India has ever produced. Subsequent philosophical thought in India was dominated by him directly or indirectly for 6 long centuries. He revolutionized Indian philosophy by introducing into it the theory of radical distinction between two mutually exclusive sources of knowledge, direct sense perception, grahana, and intellect or thought, vikalpa or adhyasaya. Now we will talk about his theory of names. According to Dignaga, all names are negative and dialectical. As all conceptual thought is nameable thought, the names are derived from the concepts, and the concepts have their sources in names. This is the fundamental statement of Dignaga. Name, the word name, name is the same thing as signifier or a word of an object. There is an object and it has to be given a name. What is a name? What is a word? What does a word signify? According to Dignaga, names or the words are negative and dialectical, and they are concepts. The names are derived from the concepts, and the concepts have their sources in names. Words are conceptual constructs. They are constituted, they are a resultant of a dialectical interaction, and they refer to the development of knowledge. Okay. The words of a language will tell us the development of that language in terms of the knowledge in that culture, how knowledge has developed, because the words are simply the bearers. They simply tell you the conceptual constructs in a given language or a given culture. Now, how this signification process begins and how it is constituted? The constitution of a given image presupposes a logical opposition with all other correlative images. It is their negation that bestows on a given image its distinctness. At the first stage, the images are confused as they correspond fairly closely to the point instant reality. But when the intellect begins to function, dialectical interaction takes place, and due to the process of conceptual opposition and negation, one arrives at a distinct image which acquires a definite name. In other words, the words or names do not signify things, but the images of the things. There is a first sense contact with the point instant reality, which is always in flux. We have the image of that thing, which resembles the thing, but which is never identical with it. And this image presupposes a logical opposition with all other correlative images. Then the dialectical process begins. To be able to understand or apprehend a given image, we apprehend it in terms of other correlative images. It is their negation that bestows on a given image its distinctness. When the intellect begins to function, dialectical interaction takes place, and due to the process of conceptual opposition and negation, one arrives at a distinct image. So that is a very it's a very important step in how the words are acquired, how words acquire signification, and how a universe of signification is constituted in a given language or in a given philosophical universe. The names do not correspond to things, but to the images or concepts of things. The names or the words do not, they do not have a direct correspondence with the thing, but they have a correspondence with the concept of the thing. But see, the important thing here is that a concept of a thing is not a thing, but at the same time it is a concept of a thing. So there is a coordination between the concept of a thing and the thing, but there is no identity. See, there is a similarity, or what is generally called similitude of there is a similitude, but no physical or absolute identity. Names and concepts are indirect conditional reflexes of reality. They are the echoes of reality. They are logical, not real. Now, this is very important. The names are logical entities. They are not real entities, in the sense that from the names, you cannot go directly to the thing. You can go only to the concept of the thing. In other words, how that thing is perceived, understood, logically correlated with other images, which are corresponding images, and then we arrive at a certain concept or a name. In the second chapter of Pramana Samuchya, Dignag discusses the two aspects of cognition, sensation and inference. He argues that their fields of operation and essential natures are dissimilar, different. For sensation, there are only the external objects. There is only the first contact with the senses, without any analysis, inference or understanding. However, the first contact serves as a stimulant for further logical inference and comprehension. In other words, the first contact does not lead to any cognition of the object, but it serves as a stimulant. I mean, without a first contact, we cannot have images also. The images are not constituted in a void. The concepts are concepts of something, of an object, even though concept and the object are not identical, they are correlative, they are derived from each other. Furthermore, the particular, the object of the senses is inexpressible. The domain of reason and knowledge is the domain of inference. This is where the acquisition of new knowledge through reasoning takes place. This is very important, that at the level of the senses, there is no name giving, there is no expression. The domain of reason and knowledge is the domain of inference. It is only when we enter in the domain of inference from the domain of senses that we enter into the domain of reason and knowledge. So, what is important to note here is that in the Buddhist theory of knowledge, of language, or of names or words, it is always a question of logical correlates and dialectical inference. Furthermore, as all reality, concrete or abstract, is eternally in flux, the reasoning process is a dynamic process. In the domain of inference and intellect, the acquisition of knowledge, the constitution of conceptual constructs, is an affair of dialectic, which is dynamic, which is always in the process of negotiating a middle path between the empirical world and the world of concepts and imagination. This is very important, that there is a world of facts, there is an empirical world, the world of facts, world of things, of objects, and then the process of understanding, the process of comprehension is a dynamic process, that this process is not static, that we do not have only a thing and we give it a name. No, how we understand, in the process of understanding, in the process of constituting images, and in the process of understanding it through through a proper dialectic, that we arrive at a certain understanding, certain conceptualization. So, this is according to, in the Buddhist terminology, this process of, this is a process of negotiating a middle path. This is what is called in Buddhism, Madhya Marg. That means, there are two extreme theories in philosophy. There is realism and then there is nominalism. In Buddhist philosophical meditation, we arrive at, the Buddhist logicians arrive at what is called a middle path, a Madhya Marg. The point of departure is our senses, with which we hold the particular without understanding it. The point of departure, the first contact, is a particular object, which we hold it in our ken, but we do not understand it yet. But this holding serves an important function, that of stimulating our imagination and intellect to apply the rules of inference by precluding what is incompatible. The incompatibility follows the laws of a power where all understanding is logical and dialectical. Now, here in Buddhist logic, the concept of the notion of incompatibility is introduced. That means that when we constitute concepts on the basis of the images of the things, we also, the correlations have to be either compatible or non-compatible. You see, there is only comparisons can be made only between two things which have something in similar and something different. So, you see, you see what is like pa, ba, cow, non-cow, you see, right, wrong, left, right. You see, you have false, true, there is, but these are compatible in the sense that both have some similarities and some dissimilarities. They can be compared. Only the comparable entities are subjected to this kind of analysis. According to Dignag, a linguistic sign reveals a part of the object to which it is applied, namely the part with which it is necessarily related, and it reveals this part by excluding what is incompatible. It is revealed in inference by intellectively positing a series of correlations, by dialectically creating the domain of poa, which by definition is hypothetical. Now, this is very important, that even the conceptual construct of a thing reveals only a part of the reality of the thing. For example, discussing the nature of man, man is rational, man is a political animal, man is mortal. See, these are several characteristics of man, and at a given time only one characteristic is revealed and the others are not revealed. It depends upon which kind of attention we are paying to what kind of which aspect. So as the linguistic sign is applicable to only one feature at a time, in the process of mental abstractions one constitutes a universe where only the pure logical constructs are admitted. So, first of all, we are dealing with names and words as conceptual constructs. Secondly, we also should realize that even these conceptual constructs reveal only a certain aspect of the reality of the object. It does not encompass the whole of the reality. Dignag says that there are two types of relations, the vritti relation that refers to the conventional use of language, and the vachaka relation that refers to the speaker's intention and the hearer's understanding of it. This is very, very important, that this we see in modern linguistics also and in all kinds of discussions on language. Language has two aspects. One, that language is already there. When a child is born, the language is already there, culture is already there. The first process is to acquire that language. Child simply learns, imitates, copies whatever is given. He participates in the linguistic phenomenon and also in the cultural phenomenon. But he also uses it. In other words, the individual, the speaker in a given community, is both a consumer of significations, that is, he learns what is given to him, he consumes, but he also creates, and the creative process is by using it. This is where the speaker and the hearer are put together. That means the language is not only learned, but it is also used, it functions, and in the very process of using the language, because two persons using the same word do not necessarily have the same semantic ranges for the same words. That means they may not have the same meanings attached to those words. They will be very much very similar, but not identical. And this dialectics between the speaker and the hearer, or the two thinking beings who talk to each other and using the word of the same language, but not necessarily with the same semantic constructs. Dignag argues that what is expressed by a word has many properties. It is not cognized through a word, for what a word refers to is due to a mental process of exclusions and inclusions. What a word refers to, it is a construct, but how this construct is arrived at, how it is constituted, it is due to a mental process of exclusions and inclusions. Some features are included, some features are excluded. In the process of dialectical interaction, new correlations are established. Okay? So, there is a new, what we call generally these days, a network of relationships. But this led to each name, each word, each signifier represents a certain network of relationships, but it is in correlation with another. I mean, the one word exists because of the other. There is a relationship between being and the other, see, and they derived what we call their being, their essence from each other. The conceptual constructs are universal. The grammatical constructs have validity only in a specific given language. Now, this is also very important. When we talk about language, we talk about language at two levels. One level of the language is its formal level, the level of phonology, pronunciation, phonetics, and the level of grammar. This is a formal level. You see, with, for example, Panini's duty was in Ashtadhyay, he presented the best possible description of the phonology and morphology of Sanskrit. When it came to Bhartrihari, he went further, and in his theory of Sufot, he presented the theory of grammar. But the Buddhist theory of language is not does not deal with the formal aspect of language, but with the conceptual aspect of language. So, then we have every object is existentially related with another with which it has a conceptual correlation. So, this we have already talked about, that this is very important. The signification of a word is always conceptual. It is only a reflection of the conceptualization of the external thing. It never refers to its specific individuality. Now, this is very important, that the names, the concepts do not refer to the specificity of the thing, but the universality of its characteristics. Finally, while there is no corresponding theory of negation or correlative exclusion in the Buddhist sense in French conceptualization from Abelard to Merleau-Ponty, there are striking parallels in the theories of perception in both the traditions. For Abelard, the French logician of the 12th century, all knowledge was derived from the sensuous experience followed by imagination and intellection. The 18th century French philosopher Condillac also insists on the sensuous experience as the point of departure for all understanding. At the same time, Condillac argues that those who remain at the level of senses only vegetate. The senses are transformed into ideas only when we constitute images of the things we want to apprehend. It is followed by the operations of abstraction and analysis of going beyond the particular to the general. All the same, the linguistic communication is a dialectical process, and without active participation, language cannot function. This is the two aspects of vritti and vachik. In this perspective, this conceptual dynamicity of Abelard and Condillac is very close to the Buddhist theory of language on which Dignaga's theory of names is based. This is the finally, this is the end of the fourth lecture. In the fifth lecture, we will talk, we continue to talk about the same theory. This theme remains the same, but we will deal primarily with the French logician of the 18th century, Condillac. Thank you.